And I'm back with Margaret MacMillan, Jack Beatty, and John Mearsheimer. Picking up where we just left off, Jack Beatty, with this notion of drawing direct lines that are useful for us today from 1914.
Well, I think you have to pay attention to regularities in history. There are certainly no inevitabilities. I agree with Margaret about that. Yet it has to be disturbing that in 11 of 15 cases since the year 1500, this according to Graham Allison, where you had a rising power and a relatively declining power, that led to war. That is what I call the Thucydides trap. And the mechanism for the trap in springing it in 1914 was the alliance system, where you had these rival alliances facing one another, and the weakest member of each alliance, Serbia and Austria, triggered the war and pulled the bigger members, Russia on one side and Germany on the other, in. Well, when you look around the world today, look at our alliance system. We're allied with Japan. Japan has a more and more nationalist government. It is potentially facing off with China over some rock piles in the East China Sea. Is that the kind of thing that could, alliance that could lead to a war? We don't know.
John Mearsheimer, I think you started this discussion talking about the impact for the role of the U.S. in the world from World War I. Pick up on that. What exactly is the legacy for the U.S. as a superpower?
Well, I think the United States' principal goal outside of the Western Hemisphere since 1900 has been to make sure that no single country dominates either Europe or Asia. I believe that the principal reason that we intervened in World War I and in World War II was to prevent Imperial Germany in the first case and Nazi Germany in the second case from becoming a hegemon in Europe. And I believe the main reason that we stayed in Europe and waged the Cold War from 1945 to 1989 was to prevent the Soviet Union, which of course won World War II, from dominating Europe. Now, if you look out forward and you look at Europe and you look at Asia, as I said before, I don't think you see any threat to dominate Europe today. I don't think Germany's in a position to do that, and certainly Russia isn't. But Asia is a very different story. I think with the rise of China, you see a situation where you have a country that looks a lot like Imperial Germany or the former Soviet Union in terms of its raw capabilities. And it's not surprising to me, therefore, that the United States is now talking about pivoting to Asia. Because again, as I said at the outset of my comments, our principal mission in foreign policy has always been to make sure that no single country dominates the Eurasian heartland. Well, and in the future, that is likely to be China.
Well, Margaret MacMillan, we're just in our last minute here, but what do you see as the legacy for the U.S. role in the world from World War I?
Well, I think one lesson we've learned in the Second World War really reinforced it was that we're better off having strong international institutions than without them. That at least if we have organizations where nations can get together, we have a way of communicating and a way of talking and a way perhaps of cutting across some of the alliance systems and a way of reassuring the smaller nations that they have some sort of stability. I'm not saying this is the solution, but I think we have at least some sense that we're all in it together. And if we engage in another catastrophic and expensive war, goodness knows what will be left.
And for the U.S. and the U.S. legacy?
Well, I think for the United States, which is very much, it seems to me, in the position that Britain was before 1914, the question is how to manage this relative change in power. And I don't think the decline of the United States is precipitous, but it's no longer as powerful as it once was. And it is having to deal with a China. But it also has dealing with a China that has other issues to worry about. I mean, China has to worry about Japan. China has to worry about India. China has to worry about some of its other neighbors. And so I think if the United States can manage this and work with some of China's neighbors and continue to try and work with China itself, it may be able to manage a transition in power. I mean, again, I'm not sure that the rise of China is going to be all that smooth. I mean, I think there are huge internal problems in China, far bigger, I think, than you had in the United States before 1914 and after 1918. So I think that there are a number of imponderable factors that we're going to just have to see how they play out.
All right. Once again, Margaret MacMillan, Jack Beatty, and John Mearsheimer, thank you all three very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you.